Hello and welcome to Architect Russell Uncensored. This is the podcast where I talk about what it's really like to be an architect. Completely raw, uncensored, I'll tell the truth, what it's really like. And today's episode, I'm going to talk about the qualifications and studying in the UK to be an architect. I'll talk about the degrees you get, what kind of work you do, the types of projects, the uni life, the group projects, the final projects. Then I talk about the second degree, how many years it is, RIBA, accreditation for the degrees, that kind of stuff that you need to look out for. Studying abroad, the course I took was international course, which involves studying abroad. And then the third part of the work, which is the part three, RIBA part three, the exams, the coursework, the log sheets, the final interview, and then finishing looking back and what I learned and other recommendations I can recommend anyone thinking about doing that kind of thing. Right, let's start off with, to give an overview of what's required, how many times I've said this, I've lost count. This is after your college, once you get into university. Right, starting from university, you need 3 years full-time study. Then you've got to work for at least 1 year, then go back to university, do 2 years, and then work for another year at least, and then you take exams and coursework and stuff. So the first part is called RIBA Part 1. That's a three-year degree. So that's your first degree you do. I did BA Honours Architecture, and it's international course, which is the only one, I think one of the only ones in the country that has an international degree. That was at Huddersfield University. So that's that first 3 years, it needs to be RIBA accredited course. It'll tell you when you, I don't know, look at the university brochure or whatever. So that enables you as an architect at the end. So that was BA Honours. Sometimes you can do BA Technology or it might be BTech or I don't know. There's different types of degrees, but as long as it's RIBA accredited, it counts towards your registration and everything at the end. So I've got my transcripts here. I'll have a look at. So it's 3 years. So the first year, I remember, you did a lot of work, but it wasn't that difficult, I found. As long as you just do the work that they say, just shut up and do the work. It's pretty straightforward, really. It's a lot of it, but it's not that difficult if you just do what you're told. I mean, the first thing was, I think we did a lot of history. You learned a lot of history of architecture. So, yeah, the first few years, there's a lot of lectures. Then the type of work you have to do was like sketching and like copying architecture drawing at the beginning. Then there was, you had to design something made of wood and then look at different connections in wood and things like that. So looking at technology, you're having lectures on technology and environment. So you're learning how things are put together. And then you get lectures on architecture, basic principles of design as well. So how you lay out different spaces. You're playing around with cardboard, doing models, see how hierarchy and all these words, hierarchy, space, form and order and what things look like, what looks good, what looks bad, those kind of things you learn. They teach you to sketch in the first year as well. Well, the course I did, they taught you to sketch. I did a bit of CAD work. That wasn't much of that, though. We went on a small field trip the first year. I think just after 3 months there, went on a trip to Paris, worked on groups, did study in urban design. We did a bit of urban design. So that was the first year. Ergonomics, a bit of interior design, ergonomics, the sizes of people and spaces. You learn the sizes of furniture and chairs and the human body, how the size of it and how all that stuff put together. Quite a lot in the first year. It's quite a lot to take in, but it's quite fun. A lot of model making. They like model making, which is a bit of a bummer. I didn't like it, but that kind of stuff. So that was the first year. I don't remember the final project in the first year, to be honest. Then going on to the second year, I actually failed my second year. I had to repeat it. So don't underestimate the second year. So that was like usually the same kind of thing. Final project I remember was a cultural center. We had to design. So you're basically doing plans a lot and you're learning how to draw and design. That mixed with a bunch of lectures teaching you stuff. I don't know, you get all these people talking about they can't sleep and everything, like staying up all night. I didn't really do all-nighters until my diploma, like 4 years later, I didn't really do all-nighters my first degree, so I don't know what people are on about when they stay up all night. Yeah, sure, you have late nights, but as long as you plan your work and everything. You need time management. As long as you do that, it's fine. I remember, the second year was a cultural center, then the third year, I did the international course. So we went to Jordan for 1 month, which was really cool. That kind of changed my life. I liked the developing culture. It was like Arabic, Middle East. It's all new to me, but I really enjoyed that. And I like the environment, and developing countries grow really fast, developing cities. I like that fast-paced environment. That's why now I live in Tanzania. I like that. It was a good initial breakthrough for me to learn a culture in another country. 1 month we stayed there. In groups, we had to do a master plan of a project. We got a section in the city, Amman. We had to design something there. But first, we had to do a master plan of this area. So we had a big site analysis of that area. Then we had to put a report together of the site analysis. Site analysis is quite a big thing as well. You have to learn to study a site, all the weather, the sound, the environment of the site, the culture of the site, sunlight, times of the day, everything about the site you need to learn. Sometimes you have to do a big booklet study of the site area before you start the project. So you do that for most projects. But this was a group one. This is the final year of the first degree. We did a group master plan, so you kind of lay out roughly where each building of this master plan is going to be, and then in groups, then after that you individually design a building on that master plan. So that was the final project. But I don't remember staying up that late doing that work. A lot of my friends were working hard. I wasn't really working hard. I just did the work fairly quickly. It wasn't, as long as you manage it and stuff, it wasn't that bad. But I was just scraping for a pass. I wasn't working my ass off, for this final project. I just did it, handed it in, and I was fine. The second year was screwed up because I had a girlfriend at the time, and I hit my head on some night out. I hit my head and kind of had a chain reaction, another healthcare issue talked about on the previous podcast. Just take care of your health. If you have an accident or something, it'll fuck up your degree. I had to repeat that. And be careful with your love life as well, because that'll screw up. Sometimes that might screw up your studies. So that was a bad time repeating the year, because if you fail one project and you have a chance to submit it again, which I did, but I lazily resubmitted it and then didn't pass. I had to repeat, because you had to repeat one project, you had to wait a whole year to do it again, so it was like a waste of years. So that was a bummer. So don't fail, just make sure you do all the work. The grade system was bloody tough, really. I'd hardly get anything above 60%. Maybe once or twice I got something above 60%, but it seemed like they had their favorites in the class. So if someone's really good, they'll base their marks on around that. So they'll compare everyone in the class to you. That felt like that was the grade system, was like that. But do what the tutors tell you. It's quite tough sometimes, because one tutor might say one thing and another tutor might say another thing. You've got to make decisions sometimes. As long as you make that decision and then stick up for it. I found that out one time. He told me to make this huge model the size of a friggin' desk of my final project. And I started it, and it's just going to be huge. And I hated making models. And he was like saying, oh, you're going to make a big cardboard model, 1 to 100 scale, 1 to 50 scale. It's like ridiculous size. And I spent all night worrying about doing this model that he was told me to do. And then I went in the next day or next few days, and I told him, he was like saying, so where's your model, have you started it? I said, I'm not going to do it, it's too big. So as long as you stick up for it, then it's fine. So big site analysis, models for your individual projects, all the 3Ds, plans, design philosophy, you have to write stuff about that. It's like a presentation of something like 6 A1 sheets, and a model and site analysis, those kind of stuff, and full-on presentation at the end. So that was in Amman, Jordan. So I did it's another cultural center. They like doing cultural centers. So that was the first degree. So anything I missed? So then after you do your first degree, which was 3 years full-time, so I got BA Honors, Architecture International. Then you have to work for 1 year at least, and you got to do log sheets. So, this is done by hand, every month you have to get your boss at work to sign it. And if you don't get them to sign it, you got them to sign it and then you send it to university. It's a bit of a weird process. I think it's all done online now, so it's a bit easier. But like, if you don't get your boss to sign your log sheets every month, proving your what work you're doing, practical experience and everything, you got to get like experience all stages of design. So mostly doing construction stuff at work, you got to get a good year's log sheets of good experience, then they'll let you back to university. You apply, and then the one I did was it was called Diploma of Architecture. It's a bit like a postgrad diploma. So that was called a RIBA Part 2. So the first degree was called RIBA Part 1 because it's RIBA accredited. Then you go back 2 more years. It's pretty standard for the UK. I think most other countries, some countries you do 5 years in one go, but UK you have to work for at least 1 year. I worked for free, which I talked about in one of my previous podcasts about the working professional experience I got. You can listen to that. So then I went back to uni, the diploma. So this was much better because I had a lot of experience compared to a lot of other people. And I remember the first day of the diploma, the tutor said to everyone, there was only like 15 people max, I think, doing diploma part two, compared to the first degree, it was like at least 50 people, which is crazy. And he said, like, the first day in part two diploma, the tutor says, you should congratulate yourselves for being in this room because it's quite rare, it's quite unique, and it's a good opportunity to go back and do your part two because not everyone does it. It's quite a small percentage of people who actually want to be an architect. So that was quite good for them to say that the first day. And then straight away, you're doing projects, like straight away, the first day, like he gives you a brief, right, you got to design this cultural center next to the waterfront in Leeds. And literally the same day, we all had to go to the site, get a train and go. And so it's like straight away, you expect... the first day that you're, that's going to take it easy. But it's the first day they give you a project and you got to start. And it was ridiculous. Like, you had to, by the following week, you had to present a site analysis. And then, like, literally 2 weeks after that, you had to present your project for a whole cultural center. It was crazy. I think it was a test how much you can basically do in, like, 2 or 3 weeks. So that was quite challenging, that. Then same thing, principles of design lectures, but this is more advanced principles of design, so I had lectures on that. Professional study, so a bit more in practice. Economics, a bit of that and stuff, and being a professional in the office, setting up a practice, those kind of things, the laws of being an architect. So I did a bit of that. You get more into that later. Bit of CAD work, we used a little bit of BIM, we learnt there's ArchiCAD. In that year we used on the Mac, so I learned a bit of that. And 3D Studio Max, we learned as well, we got taught a bit of that. I can't remember what other projects we did. We had to do an entrance, design an entrance to an existing building. We went to see a museum. I think there's other projects. So I did another international course. It was like Diploma of Architecture International. Was it Architect's Office in Arizona? We designed that. But this is before we went to Arizona, so we didn't know much about it. So that was another project we had. And we had to do construction details for the cultural center and stuff. So that, and structures lectures as well. I forgot to mention that. Structures lectures we had in the first year. And in the first BA honors, we did structural lectures, and we had structural models. You make them out of timber or something, like you'd have a building and you'd have to literally model the columns and beams and how it fits together. Sometimes you have to do a small calculation. They teach you bending moments and some bit of engineering as well in the first degree, and a bit in the diploma as well, but that's quite difficult. Not a lot of people didn't like doing that, and they scraped the pass for that. So that was structures as well. Then you have environment, like air conditioning and electronics, mechanical engineering, just basic learning, you know, air conditioning and lighting layouts and stuff. Sometimes you might have to do lighting layout for a project you're working on or something. Like, you have a design project, you have electrical engineering lectures, and they might tell you to do a lighting layout for your design project. You might have to submit that. Or the structures module, the lectures you're having for structures, they might tell you to do a structural model or draw the structure in 3D or something for your design project. So that kind of links back. Same with the first degree, you kind of did that on a basic level as well. So this is more advanced level in diploma, that kind of stuff you do. Then the final project, we went to Arizona for 1 month. That was a hell of a experience for that was one of the highlights of my uni time, I think. Stayed in Tucson for like a month, but in the University of Arizona, went on field trips every day. And we had to design a youth hostel in Tucson, Arizona. It was a bit like the trip to Jordan. We went to do something in groups, like a master plan. Did we do that? No, we didn't. We did a site analysis in groups. Big site analysis, and then we had to design our project individually there, and we had US tutors and stuff there doing the crits and stuff. It's weird because the US tutors really liked my project and they really praised it, and then came back to the UK when it got graded, and then some of the tutors didn't like it as much. They got a low grade, so that was really weird. Yeah, so that was the final project, a youth hostel. Yeah, that was the first year in diploma. And then the second year, you do your very final project. I did an apartment complex in Cambridge. You basically spend your second year in diploma just working on that a whole year. So you don't really have any lectures or anything. You're just working on your project. You're doing a site analysis, a big frigging book, site analysis, covering everything, the site you've chosen, everything about the site. It's pretty intense, like the urban grain, sound readings, traffic, oh god, future developments, everything about the site. And then you had to design your project as an apartment complex. I hated it. I just want to get it done. A lot of my projects I just didn't like that much. Trying my best to make it look good, but I was never happy. It's quite challenging. That was the time when you're staying up doing late nights, because you kind of stressed that you don't want to fail, but sometimes the tutors don't give you indications of how well you're doing. They just give you advice, but some people would just go into them saying like, oh yeah, but is it good enough, will I pass? But they would be like, they wouldn't say, they just make you work. You also had to do a dissertation on a subject of your choice. I did architecture and film. You're supposed to pick a topic, like a thesis topic, that no one's really done. I found that a bit difficult. I found something, it was like, well, how film influenced architecture and how architecture influences film. That's what I ended up writing about. But that was friggin' boring, just writing. Then you had to set the writing out professionally in a book, like label all the figures and photos, put all the contents and index, all that shit. Got to the point you're just researching shit and just rewording it how you want. So it was a bit of a shitty thing to do, really. I didn't like that. So anyway, I passed that. Then I'll talk about the uni life a bit. So I, like, first ever year I didn't get halls of residence in my very first year, the first degree. That was a bummer, big mistake. Try and get halls of residence so you meet more people. I ended up getting halls of residence in the second year. Make sure you get that, because I lived in the house first year and it wasn't very good. So that's one of the big mistakes I made. So make sure you do that. And then, yeah, it's just the usual, a lot of parties, a lot of going out. I really like the field trip. So if you ever go on a field trip, so you ever get a chance to go on these field trips, definitely go on those. Good way of learning and making the whole architecture experience more exciting. So after the diploma, so that's finishing your full-time study, but it's not over yet. You work for at least a year, and which I talked about in my previous podcast, working in the UK. So that if you want to listen to that, it's about all the experience you took. Do more log sheets for another year and then submit them. Then, this is kind of weird one I did, it's diploma / master. So if you go back to do your part three, you go back to uni, it's just basically exams, and you have to write a report on your a project you're working at work. So it's like a case study. It's not exactly like what you've been doing. It's kind of you should try and write a story, like problems that occurred, how do you solve them and stuff. It's like a report. I can't remember how many words it is, but I made the mistake of just writing everything, writing all the experience I did. Oh, I did this, I did that. It was like so much bullshit I wrote in my case study. So you have to do a case study and take exams and then interview with like a couple of members of the RIBA, and if you pass all that, then you get you're allowed to become registered architect. So that's a qualification. So I got a master's with that. Well, that's RIBA part three, it's called. Some people get a post diploma or something like that, but mine was a master's. This case study, you're supposed to prove you've worked on every stage of design, but I kind of bullshitted it a bit and like claimed I had all this experience on different stages, but I don't know, it's like pretty weird. And then the log sheets, I prove that you worked on all stages, but very difficult to work on all stages. I don't think you have to, really. And then the exams were a bummer. There's so much studying for the exams. It was like one exam was like a 1 or 2 hours, 20 questions about the construction industry, closed book. They could ask you anything. You got to answer, and you got to time your answer. So you're like 10 minutes per question. Might last some random question. What is UGBC? What are those letters? US Green Building Council or something like that. Or something weird like, God, what else was this? Random stuff. Like, it could be something in the news recently, or it could be about an architect, or it could be a regulation. It could be about a party wall act. It could be a random question that would take like 5-10 minutes to answer. What is professionalism? There's questions like that. What qualifications need to be in architect? Oh, I've done stuff like that. And then there was another long exam, open book, about architect in practice, I think it was. Yeah. How to be a professional, writing letters to clients or contractors, or bidding or things like that. You're setting up a practice. What do you need to do? Like contact your lawyer, your bank, your family, things like that. Who do you contact? It might ask you a question like that. That was like a long exam, like 3 hours or something with like 2 or 3 questions. Some of them you can get a choice which ones you want to answer, but it's a long answer. It's like a couple of pages you have to write with your pen and stuff. So that's quite difficult, especially when you're doing coursework for how many years, and then at the very end you're going to get an exam, because architecture degrees, you don't really have exams, it's all coursework. I think that's where the honours come in, it's like, that means it's coursework, so you don't really have an exam. I must have 2 small exams in my whole 5 years of full-time studying. One was, I think, history of architecture, and another one might have been something else. But then at the very end, you have these big exams. And then the other exam was about contract. Oh, Jesus Christ. Building contract between the contractor and the client. And you're like the administrator of the contract. Oh, it's just so shitty. You have to learn all this stuff. And like they ask you all these questions. Like there's an explosion on site. Well, who do you contact? What do you do? Or something like that. Or the contractor does this. Or they dig up some ruins on site. Who do you contact? What do you do? Oh, God, it's questions like that. And you have to put all the clauses of the contract. They give you a contract. You got to memorize it. You can bring it in. But you got to quote all these clauses, like contract law and everything. A lot of it's about law. Like the other one, the professional practice exam, a lot of it's about law. So you learn a bit of that in diploma, but this time, a lot of it you have to learn yourself. It's so much reading. It's crazy. Read so much about law and practice of an architect. Ugh. And I think it was like a month, 1 or 2 weeks. We went in every day at uni, and they had lectures all day and workshops all day for about a week or two, teaching you all this stuff. I think they did that like a couple of weeks before all the exams. No, I think they did a couple of months before the exams. Then you get book lists to read. So you'd have an intense 2-week course at uni teaching you stuff and workshops. Then it's up to you to study. So I just read back to back. An Architect in Practice, I think it was called, by David Chappell. I must have read that book at least 5. It's like a thick book. This must have read about like 5 or 6 times. Back to back, just kept reading it and kept reading it, making notes. It's the only way, like I found, for studying is just to read and make notes. That's the best. That's what studying is, really. I found. Same was at school. I did the same thing. You just read and make notes. That's the only way. Well, that's the only way I can found. That's what studying is for me. So that was the exams, the coursework, the log sheets, then the interview. So after you having exams, you go for the interview, and they have all that information. They have the log sheets, these 2 guys, these RIBA guys. They have your exams, your answers and questions, all that stuff. They have your CV as well, because you have to write a CV. So have all that in front of it, and they're looking at it while they interview you, and they have about an hour actually. They can grill you on anything. They're not that bad. As long as the only advice I can tell you is just to be honest, and if you don't know something, you just tell them, like, oh yeah, I need experience in that. I made the mistake trying to be a bit arrogant, but I came across as naive as well. pretending that I knew everything. Don't pretend that you know everything in the final interview. They might say to you, oh, I've noticed you don't have much site experience. Just say, like, yeah, I know, there's something I need to work on. Like, people with, I didn't realize this, but people I spoke to after the interview, I was saying, yeah, I've had a bit, yeah, I went on site, I was trying to do that, prove myself. But other people, I think who had a more successful interview than me, even though I passed, they were saying stuff like, oh, yeah, I haven't got any of that, that's something I really need to work on. So if you say stuff like that, then I think that's better, because you're more, come across more professional and honest. So don't be afraid of saying that, oh, I don't have much experience in that, because that's something you need to work on. So I think as long as you answer honestly, I think the whole interview is to make sure that you're safe as well. You're a safe architect, you're a professional, you're not going to go out and make stupid mistakes and come across as an idiot, basically. So I think that's the whole idea of the interview, really, making sure that you're just a professional, really. So yeah, so that was some of the questions they asked me. How do you manage the consultants within the RIBA plan of work? And I was like, a matrix, a responsibility matrix or something, because that's what I read. And he's got, and they were kind of laughing, saying, so how do you monitor this? And I was like, you just tick the things and blah, blah, blah. And then he goes, what else is there you can use? And one of the guys goes, like that. And goes, program, I said. And they go, yes, that's what they want. Sometimes they kind of help you as well. Sometimes you know the answer, but the answer's in there, but they're kind of bringing it out for you. And then after you pass, I think the next day they tell you you pass or not, and then, or maybe it was a few days later, and then it's just such a great feeling passing at the end of it. It's just, I never felt so good in my life. I never forget that moment when I passed, found out I passed after studying for 5 years. And then I think it took me 10 years to pass all that, to do all that. 10 years it took me to be an architect. And then when they told me I passed, God, it's like, oh, you just feel so good. Like the weight is coming off your shoulder. No more studying, no more worrying about all that shit anymore. Oh, it's such a relief finishing all that bullshit. Oh, that's what it felt like. Oh. And a lot of it, like, even when I was studying, I was like, Jesus, this is bullshit. Learning all this is really complicated. Some of it's, like, so overcomplicated. It's like, God, do you really need to learn all this shit? You don't. Like, and I said, after I finished, I thought to myself, like, God, I never want to forget all this. I want to remember all this because, like, I've read so much. I've learned so much. Literally, 3 or 4 months later, you forget it all. It's just, like, why bother? You know what I mean? Like, what was the point of it? Like, contract work. Like, we did an exam on the building contracts. Like, I never do that shit ever at work. Like, you had to learn the contract inside and out, and be administrative for a contract between the client and the contractor. It's like, I never do that at work. It's like, what is the point of that? It's like, I never understand. Like, it's like, never get involved at that work. Okay, you get a big understanding of it, but I've forgotten it all now. It's just kind of irrelevant, really, in the real world. It's a bit old-fashioned, that. I don't think you need to learn that even. The basics of a contract, but Jesus Christ. Looking back at the whole thing, I mean, the best thing about being an architect and studying all that shit, like 7 years minimum, including the work experience, the best thing is that you get a license, a qualification at the end of it. You can't get that license, registered architect in the UK, without doing all that. You must do all that. So that's the good thing about studying architecture. You've got to do all that to become licensed. Same with like doctors and lawyers, but if you're doing any other subject, I don't know, business studies or maybe an engineer, sometimes you don't need to do all that stuff. But it's a good thing, like with architecture, go all the way to be an architect, then no one will take that away from me, because you have to do all those years and work. A lot of subjects you don't need, like interior design, for instance, you just do a basic degree, or sometimes you don't even need that. You could just call yourself an interior designer. You don't need a license for that. So any profession, really, that you need a license, it's worth pursuing, really, because that's the only way to do it. But if you don't get some kind of professional license at the end of it, then it's not really worth going to uni a lot of the time, I don't think. So it's still a valid thing to go through. So it's worth it at the end because you get the qualification and you got the license and you'll be recognized. Like me, I still get recognized. My RIBA chartered membership still gets recognized around the world. So it's a good thing to have. No one will take that away from you. So it is a good investment if you go all the way. But if you don't go all the way and do the final qualifications and everything, then it wouldn't be worth it. There's no point doing a half-assed job and not finishing it. And most people, once they start working 3 or 4 years and they don't go back to finishing it, they don't, usually 90% of them, they don't. I think I worked for 3 years and I thought to myself, I have to do it this year, because the percentage of people working for 3 years in a row that don't go back and finish the part three is pretty low. So I managed to do it. I was lucky. If you're gonna do it, then make sure you go all the way. I think the location of the university, the actual uni doesn't matter, I don't think, but best to go to a city that you think you'll end up working in. There's no point. Like, I studied in this town up north, Huddersfield, and I didn't really want to work there. I didn't even like the town that much. So make sure you like pick a uni in a town you like. I thought I liked the town, but it's like raining and cold all the time and like windy. We had to walk down this hill all the time, carrying my models. I freaking hated it, the place. And I ended up going back there. I don't know why. I was a bit afraid to pick a different university. Don't be afraid to pick another university when you go back to diploma or something. Don't let that put you off, because our friends who did it and they had a great time. So not so much the uni, but make sure the city that you study is a good place, you enjoy it, or you want to maybe work there afterwards. I didn't want to work in Huddersfield, so I went to Leeds, but I wish I worked somewhere else. Just make sure the town that you study in that you like, basically, because I didn't really like it that much. What else can I say? So yeah, like I said before, just do the work, what you've been told, really. If manage your time is important. I did a whole video about time management on YouTube, you can watch. But that's one of the most important things being a student of architecture is time management. Because you get a lot of these idiots staying up late at night, and it's all over Instagram. Sleeping or not sleeping, staying up all night, all tired all the time. That's your fault if you can't manage your time. I don't like that reputation being put on architecture students. I must admit, I did it a few times, yeah, but like, there's some times, but I wouldn't. If you manage your time, it doesn't have to be like that. So location, pick the right town, do the work when you're told. Don't let outside influences influence you. That's what happened to me. I went out with this girlfriend and kind of messed with my work a lot, so I failed that year. So don't get caught up in like the social life too much. Just remember that you still have to do the work, because if you fail something, you're screwed. You have to repeat the whole year. So always have that on your mind. When I went back to do diploma, I was afraid of failing. I was really stressed, because I knew if I failed a year that I just couldn't afford or to repeat it, and it was really stressful. And I think it's one of the most stressful times doing diploma, I think. So is there anything else I can add at the end there for lessons learned? Studying abroad was a really good experience for me. I don't know what other universities do that, but I think it's helped. I don't know if it's helped me get my job abroad. It must have to some degree. The international course I did was well worth it. That's the highlight of the studying for me, is like going abroad and designing in another country. So that was definitely the highlight for me for all my studying degrees. I don't know how people could just stay in their country and design buildings there for like how many years. It was a bit of a closed door for me. I just wanted to go abroad and see what designing other buildings in other countries looked like. That was like the best thing about it for me. So I really liked that. It's worth doing if you're going to do that. It's quite expensive course. Yeah, you've got to get a lot of equipment. But nowadays, I think I didn't even do computers my first degree. I was all done by hand. So I had to buy all these pens and rulers and paper and all that shit. It was expensive. But I heard nowadays the first year is more hands-on models and stuff, but after that a lot of people are on the computers. But I must admit, I bet the computers and stuff, laptops people are getting, is pricey now as well, so you need to get all that stuff. And like, relying on the university for printing and stuff was a bit shitty, so I had to buy my own printer and everything. Yeah, that was a bummer. So you get stressed like that. Some of the tutors, like I said, if you do what they like as well, sometimes you do what you like on a project. If you just do what the tutor likes, then it's like a client. The tutors are like your client. You're kind of designing for them, so you treat it like that a bit. If they like something, just do it like they like it, not necessarily how you want it. Trouble is, sometimes you might do that one tutor, and then when it comes to the final presentation, who marks it? It might be another tutor comes along. That would piss you off. So stuff like that happens. But you can't avoid stuff like that. It just happens, really. And if you want to learn about the working in the UK, that's on the previous podcast. And then if you want to know about working abroad and everything, that's on other episodes I've done as well. So I'll see you in the next one.